Hello everyone and welcome to this week's video. Today I will be explaining F1 engines. Now F1 engines are just like your normal car engines in the way that they operate. They are piston cylinder engines. So if you don't quite understand engines yet, I have a video on piston cylinder engines with the typical cycle, and that would be a great place to start before watching this. Some things in this video might be confusing if you haven't yet watched that. So, Formula One engine, what do we got going on? Well, it is restricted to 2.4 liters and a 90 degree V8 configuration. So what that means is you've got two cylinder banks of four cylinders perpendicular to each other. So you've got four cylinders here, and they're at a 90 degree angle. That's the layout of the engine. So four valves per cylinder, much like many modern day cars. Unlike many modern day cars, it revs up to 18,000 RPM, and that is restricted. They have in the past revved higher than that, around 20,000. So what enables a Formula One engine to rev to 18,000 RPM? Well, it has to do with its bore to stroke ratio, which is very high, which means the cylinders are very wide and very shallow, so the piston doesn't have to move all that much between cycles as per revolution. So in a typical car, you may have a square bore to stroke ratio, or even a less than one bore to stroke ratio. So you'd kind of have something like this going on. This is not accurate at all. The cylinders look much more like this. And so with that, your piston isn't moving as quickly as it would be if your stroke were to be a lot greater and you're at 18,000 RPM. It'd pretty much be impossible. Flame propagation as well as the inertia of the pistons would be ridiculous. So, and one more thing, it uses a dry sump oil system. Now I haven't gone over this yet, and I probably will in a future video, but just know that what that means is it takes that oil sump, which typically is underneath, you've got your oil pan in your car. Well, you take that out and you allow yourself to lower your engine, and then you put your oil tank anywhere in the vehicle that you want and just have lines leading to the engine. So by doing that, you know, you've lowered your engine, and also you won't have that oil sloshing in there or possibly getting to the side, and that hose that's trying to suck in oil might be, when you're going around a corner at 3 or 4 G's, you know, it might just be sucking in air, and air's not great to get into your oil system. So obviously you need a different setup. A dry sump allows you to do that. So you just have a separate tank and pump in the oil directly from that. Okay, so two big differences that I'm gonna go over with Formula One engines that are different from your everyday, what I've got in my Acura four-cylinder engine. So one thing is the air intake. So if you notice when the drivers are driving, they've got that hole right above their head. That's the air intake for the engine. So what it does is it acts as a diffuser, so that high, fast-moving air goes in. A lot of people think that it's kind of to ram the air in and act kind of like an air ram, which it's not really. That's not really what it's for. The reason they do this is so they spread it out, so that slows down the air. So you would kind of lose that effect. The reason you want to slow down the air is to increase the pressure of the air as it's going into the cylinders. So by doing that, you get a better volumetric efficiency, and the air distribution between the cylinders is very even. If you had this more narrow, you know, it might just feed into one more than others. So what do I mean by better volumetric efficiency? Well, volumetric efficiency is a ratio of how much air you have in that cylinder compared to if you had the same size cylinder of air at atmospheric pressure. Now, because you've got your piston and it's sucking in the air as it moves down, it's trying to pull in the maximum amount of air as possible. The maximum it could possibly pull in would be one atmosphere, right? That seems pretty obvious. Well, it can't quite get there. It may be at, you know, 85%. So that means it's at 85% of atmospheric pressure. That's how much air is within that cylinder. So if you had something like a turbocharger or a supercharger, you can increase your volumetric efficiency above one, because the pressure inside of the cylinders is going to be greater than atmospheric pressure. So you may have two times the amount of air that you could possibly have in a cylinder at atmospheric pressure. So your volumetric efficiency would be 200%, and that's great. All right, another difference you have with F1 engines is the valve train. So if you don't understand valve trains, I've got a video on dual overhead cam versus overhead cam versus overhead valve. Those are all the three options you'd ever want to look at. So for this, I'm just going to explain the valves themselves, because this is a key difference between a typical engine and a Formula One engine. So like in my car, what I've got going on is I've got a valve and it's got a spring. So the camshaft pushes down on this valve, and then as the camshaft moves off of the valve, the spring pushes the valve to close it back again. So here's your little cylinder, and it would close it back off. Well, in Formula One, you've got pneumatic valves. So, okay, pneumatic, air pressure, so what's going on with that? So instead of a spring, you have sort of a piston cylinder device. And so this piston cylinder, this piston is attached to the valve, and then you've got the cylinder here, which is full of pressurized nitrogen. Nitrogen because it keeps its pressure fairly constant with differences in temperature. You don't want water and stuff like that in there for corrosion. So you use something like nitrogen. Now, as your camshaft comes and it pushes down onto your valve, it will press in this piston. And so that pressure, once that cam comes off of the valve, that pressure is going to be what pushes the valve back to the closed position. So by switching to a pressurized air system, or pressurized nitrogen rather, system, what you do is you eliminate the weight of that spring, first of all, and you can rev to higher RPMs because air is going to be a little more consistent, and you don't have to worry about the valve kind of floating, the spring not pushing it back fast enough. So it's a better system for these kind of ridiculous RPM numbers that you get with Formula One engines. So that's my overview here. One thing I guess I did not mention was the air intake. There is a reason they put that up as high as possible, basically, and that's so that you get cool, clean air. If you put it near the road, you know, you're going to have warmer air, and also it's going to be turbulent. You don't want turbulent air. You're not going to get as much. You would decrease that volumetric efficiency I was talking about. So they place it as high as possible, get nice laminar air to go in there, nice and cool, maximum amount of oxygen. So that's Formula One's, and I'll just show a quick picture of one of these intakes, just if you haven't seen that. And so here you can see three different cars, and just kind of how the air intake system evolved over a couple of years. And you can just look at the different ones there, but once again, right above the driver's head for that cool, clean air. So here's another useful image. This is actually back when they used 10 cylinders. But regardless, you can get the ideas from it. If you see that yellow sort of ring going around the top of the engine, that's actually where that air intake is going to kind of attach. You can see those little bolt points right there, so that you'll have the even airflow to each of those cylinders. You can see all the openings for the intake for each of the cylinders, and those little cylinders right above them are the fuel injectors. And so then obviously you can see the exhaust manifold, the shiny chrome on the outside, and in the bottom left, the multi-plate clutch.